This is a broadcasting history interview which we're doing in Sioux City, Iowa on July 13th of the year 2000. And we are here in the midst of one of the most remarkable collections of radio broadcasting artifacts and memorabilia that I have ever seen, and with a remarkable gentleman who has been responsible for collecting it and also documenting much of the history that goes with it. That history being focused on broadcasting here in Sioux City in Northwest Iowa. His name is Sam Seldon, and he has devoted his professional life to radio engineering. So we've sort of turned the tables on him here today. We've got him in front of the microphone and in front of the camera instead of behind it. And we're going to talk with him for the next few minutes about your experience, Sam. When did you get into radio engineering?
Well, thank you, Grant. You're very very kind. My radio days started probably while I was still in high school. I was interested. I got out of service and out of high school and attended Coin Radio School in Chicago in 1946, or was it 1945? I stand corrected.
Yeah.
And then I went into service after that as a communications electrician.
Okay.
And when I got out of service, then I did radio servicing and then went to Omaha Radio Television Institute and got my first cast license, and then went into broadcasting.
And you went to work then in approximately 1950 for a Sioux City station?
First I went to KWPM in West Plains, Missouri.
Oh, okay.
And there a short stint. Jobs weren't as plentiful as they are nowadays, so you took what you could get.
Uh-huh.
But I did move back shortly after, in about 1950. And I've been in Sioux City ever since.
And you began your career then with KTRI.
That's correct, radio station KTRI.
As an engineer for KTRI.
Right.
And then you became the chief engineer there.
Yes, about 2 or 3 years later.
Mm-hmm. And you held that position then for quite a number of years.
Probably as chief for over 20 years at KTRI.
Okay. And during the course of your career then, you have also been associated with a station that we're going to talk a lot about today and one that you care a great deal about, which is KSCJ.
That's correct. I've been chief engineer there for over 20 years also.
Uh-huh. And so you're responsible even today for the engineering on that station.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Well, you have sort of made it your mission to not only collect some wonderful examples of this industry, but also to document the history of radio broadcasting here in Northwest Iowa and in Sioux City. You've spent a lot of time working on this.
That's correct, because as I searched through the library and the museum, I found very small amount of documentation on any of the stations, and I felt there was a need for it because I knew many of the personalities, both engineering and management, since radio's concept, and I felt I needed to do that.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've certainly done a wonderful job of it. We're going to be referring, as we go through the interview today, to a set of narratives and pictures that Mr. Seldon has put together, which really traces both the ancestry and the development of radio broadcasting in Sioux City. And I'd like to just sort of have you walk us through that, Sam, because I think many people lose sight of the fact that radio organized broadcasting didn't really start until the 1920s, but it was preceded by a lot of experimentation. And you had a very early experimental station on the air here in Sioux City.
Yes, it was pretty much amateur radio.
Sure.
Even before World War I, amateurs were licensed, and they did experimental work. And the first large station was called 9ZU, which was an experimental station. There's about 19, in the mid-teens, and mm-hmm. they were shut down, of course, during the World War.
Uh-huh.
But right after that, they did come on and build a station at the Grandview Park.
Okay.
By the water towers.
All right. And they operated, they were operating prior to what we consider the formal licensing of broadcast
yes,
stations.
Yes, they were actually on the air before licensed broadcast as a spark transmitter
okay.
up there.
So they were a code station or a spark wireless.
Right, that is correct.
Yeah, all right. But probably some playing around, as a lot of people with spark wireless were doing, on putting some a grid modulation on that.
That is correct. Mm-hmm. Yes, they did become voice
uh-huh.
for, it wasn't a license, but as many of them did then.
And so this was a transition out of dots and dashes, wireless, to actually putting the human voice on the air.
That is absolutely correct.
So this, did this have a connection then to what you would identify as the next station in this progression?
Yes, it would be WEAU. There was a fellow by the name of Ben Davidson, which is affiliated with the Davidson Brothers department store.
Okay.
Ben especially was very interested in what was going on up there. And he sold, the boys up there sold their interest to Ben Davidson.
All right.
Who then helped organize the Davidson Brothers radio station, WEAU, because they were interested in selling radios, tubes, batteries, and speakers,
okay.
and that sort of thing from their department store.
So there is a direct connection then back to W9ZU to WVAU.
Okay. Right. In fact, some of the equipment that was up there also went down to WEAU.
Well, that and the motivation for that, as it was in many cases, was to sell radio sets.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, the manager, Joe Levine, that took over in 1922, was the head of the radio department to sell, and he automatically became manager of the radio station.
Okay, at Davidson Brothers Department Store, which is a very familiar landmark to
right.
Sioux Cityans.
That's correct, at 4th and Pierce.
4th and Pierce. And so they were operating, now this is now a commercially licensed station.
Yes, it is, mm-hmm. definitely.
About how many years did they operate it?
They operated until 1927.
Uh-huh.
Their equipment was becoming old and obsolete, and it required about $35,000 to upgrade, and Davidsons were no longer interested.
Uh-huh.
So the manager of the station at that time, Harold Corkill, approached the Sioux City Journal Publishing Company, asking them if they would be interested in providing a high-powered radio station for Sioux City.
Uh-huh. And what happened at that point?
And at that point, the Journal was interested and did apply for one. And they were assigned the call letters of KSCJ, which stood for the Sioux City Journal. And Harold Corkill became the manager. And the engineer that was at WEAU, Walter Dukeman, became the engineer for KSCJ.
And the call letters KSCJ are got to be familiar to anybody who lived through the 30s, 40s, 50s, and even up to today. It's still that
very
call
definitely. In the 30s and even the early 40s, there was no competition. There was no television, no videos, and all that sort
no
of thing.
No other radio stations.
Very few radio stations.
Right.
So if they wanted local news, they tuned to KSCJ.
And all kinds of local programming.
That's correct.
Right. One of the remarkable things that you have done, Sam, is you've accumulated the copies of the original licenses for this whole sequence. And you remember what the Perkins brothers were, the publishers of the Sioux City Journal.
That's
right?
Correct.
Not really renowned for being free with a dollar.
right. That is correct.
But in their application,
I didn't say that. You said
I
it.
Said, well, I'll tell you, they can't get to me anymore.
No.
But in their application, they said, what was it? they do this, but if they could break even.
They could even break even because they were not interested in making money off the station in the first place. And there's a reason for that, because the Federal Radio Commission, which is now the FCC, were very, very stringent. Your rules you had to follow, you had to show a public interest, and if you didn't, they would take you off the air. So I think that is part of the reasoning, because if I remember correctly, the Perkinses were interested in making money but not spending money.
Now you said it very precisely and succinctly. It's been,
it's a well-known fact over the years.
And I worked briefly for the Perkins organization too. In fact, I owe the beginning of my career, and I will just segue to that, to a man named Gene Flaherty, who was the steward of that radio station for the Perkins family for many, many years. Now, I understand you didn't actually work for him, but you must have had some, known a lot about
Gene
Flaherty.
Yes, I did. And him and Elizabeth Sammons, who was related to the Perkins, mm-hmm. she was managed it also, along
right.
with Gene Flaherty. And I did. There was a chief engineer at that time by the name of Steve Dyer,
uh-huh.
who was a Colonel Steve, and he was also involved in the services, and
mm-hmm.
he was away at the time. But I did work some with Steve,
okay.
and with Al Smith also, who was the engineer.
And Al Smith, again, is a very renowned figure in broadcasting in Sioux City from your end of the equation as the engineer, wonderful
yes.
engineer.
Yes, he was my mentor from the time I graduated from radio school, and all my life I've always admired the man, respected him.
And he put he wasn't the first chief engineer for KSCJ.
No, Walter Dukeman was first. Then in 1929 he left, and Steve Dyer took over.
Okay.
And then when in the mid 30s, why Steve left for the service,
mm-hmm.
and Al Smith took over, and Al was instrumental in building the four tower array north of Sioux City.
Okay.
After being on Prospect Hill,
mm-hmm. uh-huh.
Al was also involved in the FM station, KSCJ FM.
All right.
Which was way ahead of its time.
Mm-hmm. When did it go on the air, do you remember?
It went on the air in about 1948.
That was right in the beginning then.
Right in the beginning,
right.
when the FCC changed frequencies.
When nobody thought FM would ever make
ever
any
amount
money.
To anything, that's right.
Well, we've been wrong about
we've
some
been
things.
Wrong, yes.
Yes, we have. Well, just to go back to Flaherty for a moment, a genial Irishman, a good guy, but again, pretty close with the dollar.
Yes, no. Very definitely.
Well, he gave me my first job, so he didn't overpay me, but I value the...
No, if I recall, we made about $45 a week.
Yeah, well,
full time.
As a student, I didn't make that much.
Oh, boy,
but
all right.
Then I was part-time. Well, that's... Now, this is a community radio station that has just some incredible history associated with it. You recall these two legendary morning men that did the Town Crier program.
Yes, Ray Murphy and Rodney Dean.
Yeah.
They did the Town Crier, and that was the most listened to program ever in the Siouxland area. People depended on them.
They just owned it.
They just owned it. They were involved in every parade, every doings around town.
Yeah.
So, and Ray Murphy, in turn, came from KWUC, which was a Lamar station that did have a studio here in Sioux City.
Was that Lamar station a college station?
Yes,
then?
Western Union College.
Okay, and they eventually got bumped off the air.
They got bumped off the air because of not following the rules, not serving a community service.
Okay, but again, a connection here between that fledgling college station and this, what became this big booming, what was the KSCJ frequency?
1330 at that time.
But you were on, they were on some other frequencies prior to that.
Yes, they were.
As many stations
were. Yes, they were on 1250 and as well as 1100. And there were a couple other frequencies.
Uh-huh.
They shifted around for the first few months.
And that was, they were getting shuffled around in
yes,
that whole business.
Right.
Well, let me go back to the town criers, and then again, let's and sort of connect this to something that's still go to the concept of public service radio. They started something called the Yellow Dog promotion.
The Yellow Dog Auction, yes.
The Yellow Dog Auction. What was it?
Mm-hmm. The Yellow Dog Auction was a way of Ray Murphy's method of, at Christmas time, to earn some money for the underprivileged kids and buy them some toys.
Uh-huh.
And this started in 1935,
uh-huh,
when Ray and Rodney were in there. And it has been going every year since that time, and KSCJ proudly has broadcast every service, and I've been involved in it 21 years on the Yellow Dog, along with Don Stone. Yes.
And Don Stone has been the MC on that.
Yes,
for
all these years.
And again, Don turned into kind of a legendary figure in broadcasting before he decided to be a banker, didn't he?
Very much so. Don Stone had been with KSCJ for 37 years, and he held many programs, the afternoon matinee, shopper's matinee, from the old Toller's Rexall drugstore, as well as Rhythm Room and many programs.
He also was involved with the television station, Channel 4.
Yes, Channel 4 in later years.
Right.
And here I'm talking 40 years ago.
Yes, right. Well, it's time does keep going by. Honestly.
Yes, it does.
Right. Now, let's begin. Let's segue then to this other set of call letters that became pretty well known in Sioux City, and that's KTRI. There's a newspaper ownership connection there.
Yes, there is. KTRI stands for the Tribune, which at one time there was a Sioux City Journal in the morning.
Morning and afternoon papers.
Right, and Tribune was in the afternoon. The Tribune was owned by the Kelly family here of Sioux City, while the KSCJ was owned by the Perkins.
Mm-hmm.
So in 1938, they decided to put their own station on, and that was on 1420 or 1450 at the time. And they were a 250-watt station located at 212 Commerce Building with a single tower on top of the Commerce Building, a 200-foot tower.
Downtown Sioux City.
Right, which is a landmark for many years.
Right. And you went to work then for that station in approximately
1950,
and became the chief engineer.
In 1952 or 3, yes.
And that station was managed by a name named Dietrich Dirks.
Yes, at the beginning.
Uh-huh, at the beginning.
Right. And in 1949, Dee left to start radio station KCOM, which is now KMNS.
So that was a station that was at the lower end of the dial, a low frequency.
Yes, 620. And though they were 1,000 watts, they did have the same coverage that the 5,000 watt stations
because
had.
Because of the low frequency.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you became the chief engineer and continued in that position then for some 20 years.
Up until 1974.
Mm-hmm. And KTRI, did they ever increase power then? Or?
They've been 5,000 watts since they moved to their transmitter in 1948.
Okay, they
moved from the Commerce Building to Dakota City with their transmitter.
That's right. But that tower was still on top of the Commerce
Building. Yes, they remained up there through the flood of 1952.
Uh-huh.
And then while their chief engineer, Will Easterly, was gone on vacation, they quickly dismantled that tower because of the insurance cost.
I see.
Although during the flood, we did use that tower, and we put in the studio again up there.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Because it was...
The one at Dakota City had been flooded out, and I was one of them out there when we got 31 inches of water, and took a boat all the way back into Sioux City from Dakota City.
So the transmitter site out there was totally...
Wiped out, so we bought a 250-watt Collins unit, had it brought in here, and operated out of there about a week.
Okay. From the
top, the 212 Commerce Building.
Okay. Well, that's an what's memorable to you about your experience at KTRI?
Probably the fact that although I was there 24 years, I had 1 year's experience 24 times over, because things didn't change then. You used the same turntables, you used everything the same year after year after year. It's altogether different nowadays, where equipment doesn't wear out, it becomes obsolete and has to be upgraded. Mm-hmm. That was probably, and the fact the flood of 1952, where I'd take a boat all the way from Dakota City into Sioux City, that was my most memorable experience.
So you would have been marooned out of the transmitter site if you, where did you get the boat?
The Coast Guard and different Army auxiliary boats, they had a boat out there for us and brought us in.
So they rescued you from the transmitter site?
Yeah, they rescued you in one of those pontoon boats.
I see. So you just abandoned that transmitter
site? We abandoned it, yep.
There was a lot of damage out there?
Not as much as expected. Somehow we managed to lift some of the heavy transformers up on the blocks.
Uh-huh.
I do remember that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, as you've let's kind of trace a little more of the connections here now, because there is a connection between KSCJ and Dirk Station. What were the callers on that again?
KCOM.
KCOM, which is known now
as KMNS.
As KMNS. Comes television, and Channel 9 is already on the air. I guess they weren't contested, were they?
No, they weren't.
Their predecessor went on the air,
yeah.
KVTV.
Yeah.
But Channel 4, the D. Dirks filed an application, and the Sioux City Journal filed an application.
Yes, they did.
And they sort of had an eyeball standoff for a number of years. And
yes, they did. That's correct.
Decided to merge their interests and went together in the operation of that station. And Dirks managed it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, and that sort of brings Al Smith back into the equation.
Yes. Al Smith had worked at KSCJ till 1947 or so.
Uh-huh.
And then he went with D, and they put KCOM on the air in 1949.
So he put that radio station
right
on the air.
Right. And mm-hmm. then he remained with them 3 years probably, till Channel 4 went on the air. And then he went back to the Journal, and D moved over there.
Okay.
And then he put Channel 4 on engineering.
He put Channel 4 television on the air then.
Right.
Right. And he was the architect of one of the first really tall towers.
Right, that's correct. A 2,000-foot tower.
Mm-hmm.
That was located northwest, northeast of Sioux City. And Channel 9 and Channel 4 both are on.
Which at that time was a little unusual.
Very
for two
much
stations
so, yes.
To be on the, have their antennas
right
on the same tower.
That's yeah correct.
Al Smith was a nice guy.
Very, very nice. The nicest person I ever known for engineering.
Yeah, really remarkable man.
Yes, he was.
Yeah, really. Well, what do you, you know, you're living in a totally different technical world today. As you look back and as you look over some of this equipment that you've collected, it must just boggle your mind to think what's happened in these just a little over 80 years.
I know it. In just the 50 years that I've been involved, from the old 78 RPM players to CDs, that changed.
Yeah.
From tubes to transistors and integrated circuits.
Yeah.
It's a totally different world than when I first started.
Mm-hmm. A lot easier to maintain.
Well, yes. It takes less maintenance because the tubes were so erratic, they were constantly changing and parts had to be. When I started, there was one chief engineer and three full-time engineers.
Yeah.
And now one engineer can handle four stations,
yeah,
which we do.
Yeah.
Well, so there's that little of maintenance now.
So it certainly is it's a different world.
It's a whole different world.
In so many ways.
Yes.
Right.
I still love the old tubes from the radios because of the smooth velvet sound they get, uh-huh. but that's a thing of the past.
Yeah, right. Well, as we look around this room, and Nate can't get a full, we'll get some video of it in a few minutes, but you've got just some beautiful examples of early radio receiving equipment here, Sam.
I've always been interested in radios, of course, first because I was a radio serviceman, and my goal has been to collect, right from the beginning, the commercial receivers, up until the mid-50s when they changed to transistors. So I've tried to collect in chronological order the receivers as they progressed, uh-huh. and keep track of the improvements that were made over the years. And I'll have to admit, probably in the mid to late 30s, about 1938, some of the best AM receivers that were ever made was during that period because of the quality, the cabinets, and the workmanship.
Mm-hmm.
After that, it deteriorated.
And they produced some great sound.
Yes, they did, yeah. And I'm still fascinated with them.
Right. Well, again, not everything that changes.
Changes for the best, that's true.
Let's look back. I think, Nate, can you get a shot of that, the one with the sort of the etching in the front? And let's talk about that. Well, that's the most remarkable example of a receiver that I can ever remember seeing.
This is actually a battery-operated radio. It took the A battery and the B battery, along with a horn speaker,
yeah.
Which is characteristics of the mid-20s, 1925-1926.
Yeah. And what was the manufacturer's name on that?
That was made by Metrodyne, the Metro Electric Company. And if you can pan over just one more here, we've got a Zenith. A Zenith was always a super good radio. This is called the Walton set because it was a set that was used on the Walton's TV program. But they had the big, beautiful, round, black dial that would pick up the foreign countries and had a beautiful sound to it. Terrific woodwork in it, yeah. Craftsmanship. So this is 1938 as compared with 1926.
Let's kind of drop down to the lower shelf there. I'm not sure whether Nate can get that or not, but if not, we'll get it later. That one looks to me like it must be something pretty early.
So this one here is a Kennedy Model 5 from about 1923. It's got the three tubes exposed with the gas being emitted out the top, so it's very much of an antique radio, still mm-hmm. very attractive. They used a horn speaker.
Could you, where in the world did you find something that old that's in that good condition?
That one I bought in Minneapolis from another radio collector up there.
Hmm. Well, could we slip over just one more again, the one just to the to your right of that?
This one right here?
It's an interesting looking
set. Okay, that was made by RCA. That's a Radiola 20.
Mm-hmm. What era would that be then?
That would be pretty much the same era as this one here,
okay.
when they had the slanted front.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, why don't we stop at this point, and we're going to then, and we will take a look at then at a really, really early radio set, which Sam has here. So
I'll go and take. Go ahead.
Now we're resuming the interview now with Sam holding an example of one of the earliest radio receiving devices, which was the old crystal set. This was a manufactured version of it, Sam.
All right, this was made by Westinghouse in 1922. It's called an Areola 1 crystal set because they used a geranium crystal. It was a portable. You could put your earphones right in it, although it took a couple batteries. No, this one was a crystal set, and it didn't need no batteries, but it did need a long antenna and your headset. And it was made, as I mentioned, by Westinghouse, and it's the Areola 1, 1922. They made a series of four of these. The next one had one tube, the next one had two tubes, and the next one had an additional two tubes for a speaker.
Well, a lot of people built these out of, they were home builds built out of kits, right?
That's correct. This was the first commercial radio, but a lot of them were built the home brew type that was made by a local amateur, or you could buy kits or diagrams and build your own set.
Well, for the first time, maybe you can explain to me the difference between a crystal set and a set that operated off tubes.
A crystal set has no tubes, no batteries. All it took was an antenna and a ground, and you tuned the crystal until you got a good hissing noise, and then you tuned your station in until you got it the best. Where a tube type would amplify the signal.
Uh-huh. Wonderful. Great explanation.
All right. Thank you.
Could you set that down? All right. Let me ask you, where did you acquire that?
I don't recall, be honest with you, where I got that. I've been collecting about 30 years now. So
can't be too many of those around.
No, there aren't. I wish I'd have kept better track of where I got my things.
Well, now, this microphone then would represent a similar era. This is a very, very early microphone.
This is called a carbon button, double button microphone used by broadcast stations in the mid to the late 20s. The thing would become tight and you'd have to rattle it a little bit in order to shake the carbons loose. And the springs were so that any vibration on the floors wouldn't jiggle things.
In a lot of the early radio experience photography, you see microphones that have sort of this spring configuration, but this is a very early version.
Yes, this is the broadcast mic. That's correct.
Well, now, in your collection, you have this microphone is not ancient, but it's remarkable for where it was in its experience. This is a mic, you tell me, that was actually in the KDKA operation.
That's correct.
First broadcast station with a program, sir.
Yes, this is the Western Electric Model 639. It's called the Bird Cage, and it's from about 1939, so it was not among their very first, but it was used at KDKA for many years, and I do have documentation from a former chief engineer that it was used for that. So I'm very proud of this microphone.
Well, you have every reason to be. Now I'm gonna hold this monster because Sam tells me, and I have no reason to not believe that it's true, that I once sat in front of this particular microphone.
Well, I believe so. If you worked at KTRI,
and I did,
and I'll take your word for it, then this microphone was from that period, and that's one of the microphones that were used in the studio.
This is a RCA ribbon mic. It was a real
workhorse
of the broadcast industry.
They made you sound like something you weren't because the quality.
Made even me sound good. Well, this is the microphone that sat on that table in the studio that was right outside the control room where we did most of the station break announcing, did a lot of newscasts from there and everything.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So that's a very, a lot of the network pictures have these.
Yes, they do, very definitely.
Workhorse.
Workhorse, that was one of the workhorses of the industry.
Certainly was.
What a time. Yeah. 55 years passes, and here is Grant with the same microphone he started out with.
I never expected for this to happen.
I'll bet you didn't.
You do a very complete job, Sam.
Thank you.
Believe me. That is remarkable. Well, I think that pretty well covers it for the interview then. This is KTRI Sioux City, 212 Commerce Building, downtown Sioux City.
Example of the most classy radio of the 1938 era.